Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.
When you have got a question and you just can't figure it out, just give us a shout and call the Homework Hotline. The Homework Hotline. The Homework Hotline. The Homework Hotline.
Welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Craig Zaremba.
And I'm Donna Minio. Homework Hotline is the place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or on TV.
Here's how it works. Teachers from Dial a Teacher are standing by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
If you would like help with your homework, call Dial a Teacher free at 1-888-986-2345.
You can also send us your questions on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Just click on the Yak Back button and send in your question. Ready?
It's Tuesday, and that means it's time for tonight's creature teaser.
All right, this mammal is related to the camel and can be found in South America. Unlike the camel, this creature does not have a hump and is smaller in size. It has a long neck, large head, and big pointed ears, and is pale brown with white undersides. It lives high in the mountains or the Andes Mountains, as well as the plains, plateaus, and coastal lines of Argentina, Chile, and Peru. Excuse me.
This herbivore lives in groups with one dominant male, up to 10 females, and their young. The unattached bachelors live in their own groups, or herds, of 50 or more. Newborns are called chulengos. They are able to walk as soon after birth and can keep up with the herd immediately.
Cool.
Yeah. If you think you can solve the creature teaser, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904 or just answer it on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly and you could have a chance to share the answer at the end of the show.
Every correct response we added to our Hotline Hall of Fame earn enough points, and you can win a tablet at the end of the season. Cool. We have some homework.
Yes, we do. I think we have Sincere on the phone. Hi, Sincere. How are you?
Hello.
Hi.
How are you?
Good.
Good. You sent us a question, so I have it typed up over here on the board, so come on over with me, and let's go over this, okay?
Okay.
All right, so the question that you gave us was, six lawns mowed cost $15. What is the cost of one lawn? Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay, so sounds like you're doing some review right now of the first module in seventh grade. So the cost of one lawn, what is that called? What are we finding?
We are gonna find how much money it costs to mow one, how much money the person gets to mow one lawn.
Exactly, and that's called the unit rate. What is it for one thing? Like sometimes you go out to the store and you're buying things and it's like two for $10. Well, how much would it be for one? Okay, that's a unit rate. Anytime you're asking for one, it's a unit rate, okay?
Okay.
All right, so let's figure out how we're gonna set this up. I have six lawns. They cost $15. I want to know the cost for one. So I would put my proportion together with the money or the cost on top of the number of lawns. All right?
Okay.
All right, so what is the one thing we definitely know? What can we circle in this problem? We know
that that it's $15 to mow six lawns.
$15 and six lawns. So we know that fraction for our proportion, right?
Yes.
So I'm going to say $15, and we're going to do that over six. So now what are we trying to find? I'm going to put that in a different color so it's easier to understand.
We are trying to find how much he would make for one lawn.
Okay, so the cost for one lawn, that's our other proportion. But we don't know the cost, right? So right. We have to put a variable in there. What variable do you like to use?
X.
Okay. So we're going to put an X, and then we're going to put it over 1. There's our unit rate, okay?
Okay.
Now, how have you been taught to solve this problem? You have two fractions that are equal to each other. What have you been taught?
You have to cross multiply.
Okay. So I'm going to do 15 times 1, and what do I get?
You get 15.
And then I'm going to do the 6 times X. What do you get?
6X.
All right. So now I have a one-step equation, correct?
Yes.
Okay, now how do I solve a one-step equation?
You will have to divide by a coefficient.
Okay, and what's my coefficient? I love the terms you're using.
6.
6, so if we divide by 6, why are you doing that? Why do you want the 6 divided by 6? What are you trying to get?
You're trying to get x by itself.
X by itself, or 1x. So I have 1x, because 6 divided by 6 is 1. Now, let's do 15 divided by 6. We're going to do it longhand over here off on the side.
Okay.
And the numerator goes inside and the denominator is on the outside. Okay? So now, yes. How many 6s are in 15?
2.
So 2 times 6 is?
12.
Okay, now we're just going to subtract that. What's 15 minus 12?
15 minus 12 is 3.
Now, because we're talking money, we have to go 2 decimal places, okay?
Okay.
So we're going to bring up a decimal. We're going to bring down a 0. Now I've got 30 down there. So how many 6s are in 30?
There are 5.
5. So 5 times 6 is?
5 times 6 is 30.
And now when I subtract that, I have 0. But that's not how we write money, is it?
No,
we actually have to, we really don't need to show it, but how many 6s are in 0?
0.
So now the final thing, I got 2.50 for my answer. But what was my answer? What were we finding? What's the
money.
Label?
We were finding how much it costs.
Okay.
I mean, how much it gets paid.
For one lawn, right?
Yes.
And how do we write money? What's the label for money? You know, it's that little S with the two lines through it.
Dollar sign.
The dollar sign. Because anytime you do a word problem, you should get used to labeling your answer, okay?
Okay.
So you found that one lawn is going to be $2.50. All right? And how would you check your work?
You would substitute $2.50 for X.
Okay. I'm writing that here over 1. Gotcha. And then you had 15 over 6, right?
Yes.
Okay. So now what are you doing? How do I know if they're equal or not?
So now you would...
Just like before.
You cross multiply.
So 15 times 1 is?
15 times 1 is 15.
And then we got to do $2.50 times 6. What's 0 times 6?
0 times 6 is 0.
And 6 times 5?
30.
Now carry the 3. 6 times 2?
12.
Plus 3?
15.
15, and I have 2 places in my number behind the decimal, so I've got to have 2 places behind the decimal in my answer. So we're going to move that over. So we have 15 is equal to 15. And since it worked, it checked out. All right, Sincere?
Okay.
You did a great job.
And I also have an answer for the creature teaser.
Oh, honey, you got to call back. You can't do that right now. You'll give it away to everybody.
Okay.
Okay? Thank you.
Need help with your homework? Call Dial a Teacher for free at 1-888-986-2345. And don't forget, Dial a Teacher is open Monday through Thursday from 3:30 to 7 p.m.
All All right, we're going to go back to the questions in just a minute. Tonight we head to the Binghamton Zoo to learn about the Shetland sheep. Take a look.
The scientific name of the Shetland sheep is Ovis aries. There are different types of sheep. There are actually over 200 different types of sheep. What makes sheep different is primarily what they're bred for. Sheep are domesticated, so it basically depends what the different breeds people want them for. They're used for dairy, they're used for meat, they're used for their hair, their wool. They're also used for their hides. So it's basically what they've been bred to be used for. Shetland sheep geographically are located in the Shetland Isles, which are a small chain of islands off the coast of Scotland. So primarily now their habitat is going to be farmland, sort of pasture. They're very common in very rough areas where there's a lot of rocks and stuff. So they're a little bit more hardy. They don't need like a rolling pasture land. Shetland sheep and sheep in general are primarily herbivorous. So they only eat grasses. They also, when they eat, do something called cropping, which is where they take basically the blade of the grass a little bit above the ground. So they're pretty hard on any pasture land they go through, where they crop it so low that the grass can't generally come back. All sheep are basically related back to two animals, one of them being the mouflon. It's a wild sheep found in Europe and Asia. Males are called rams. They can be anywhere from 90 to 125 pounds. Females tend to be, which are called ewes, can be a little bit smaller. They're anywhere from 75 to 100 pounds. We have three Shetland sheep here at our zoo. We have Bane, who is our ram. We have Joker, who is a wether. A wether is a male sheep who has been neutered. And then we have Robin, who is our female. Robin, Joker, and Bane came to us from the Staten Island Zoo. And Robin, this past summer, had triplets. So her and Bane have been working on expanding their family. So we're pretty sure we're gonna be getting triplets again, because they tend, if they have had triplets or twins in the past, they tend to have triplets or twins in the future. Sheep do generally live in groups. They have a behavior called flocking, which is where they're pretty good about following the leader. They want to be in a group. This generally applies to groups of four or more. We have at the zoo a group of three, so they don't really flock. They sort of scatter. They don't flock as much. But it also means if they're out in a field and they're eating, they want to be next to each other and they tend to group up, which is something that farmers can use when they're farming them, where you can sort of set them out to pasture. They're all going to stay in a clump. You're generally not going to have one wander off. Shetland sheep specifically are used primarily for their wool. They're actually one of the few sheep that are, they have a very prized wool. It's supposed to be very, very soft. A conservation thing with the Shetland sheep was that at one time, people sort of, it's very similar, I guess, with dogs, that they sort of breed for a certain characteristic. And with the Shetland sheep, they really liked their fur, their wool, but they're a much smaller sheep. So a smaller sheep means less wool. So they started interbreeding them, trying to get that nice wool, but on a bigger sheep. In the 80s, they were being so bred out that there was actually worry that they would no longer be a specific breed, because there were so few of them that were just specifically Shetland. And there was a group, I believe, from the Shetland Isles that sort of bred up a herd and sort of brought them back. Just by breeding them for characteristics we wanted, we sort of kind of bred them out of existence, but kind of brought them back once we realized what was happening.
All right, that was pretty cool.
Yeah, it was. And, you know, we were talking that I have some wool sweaters and things like that.
So. And the nice thing with wool is it still insulates even if it gets cold or gets wet. So it's a good thing to wear in the wintertime. If you get it wet, it'll still maintain some insulating properties.
So I shouldn't be wearing cotton, huh, on a snowy day like today.
Cotton will kill you in the wintertime if it gets wet. It just sucks the heat right out of you. So.
Want to know more about this animal and others like it? Go to our website, homeworkhotline.org, and click on videos.
All right, we have Aaron, I believe.
I believe we have Aaron.
Hi, Aaron. How are you?
I'm doing good.
All right, good. You have some exponent math questions, yes?
Yes.
Come on over to the board. I've got them up here for us, all right?
Yes.
So I have these numbers here. Take a look. I got 15 squared times 13 to the fifth power. I have 20 squared times 18 to the third. And then I have 10 to the negative first power times 20 to the third power. Are those our questions that we're working on?
Yes.
All right, and you'll notice I got our handy-dandy Texas 84 computer calculator up there, because we're going to be working with some big numbers here, okay?
Okay.
All right, so first thing we're going to do, what does the exponent mean?
An exponent means, like, for example, let's say if it was 15 to the third power, that means 15 times 15 times 15.
Okay.
But now we're dealing with 15 to the fifth power, meaning it's 15 times 15 times 15 times 15 times 15.
All right, good, Aaron. So I got 15 squared, which means 15 times 15, all right? And then I'm going to multiply that unit or that by 13, like you said, times 13 times 13 times 13 times 13. And I'm using the little dot to represent multiplication there, okay?
Okay.
So I'm going to come over to our calculator here, and I'm going to say, okay, 15 squared. So I'm going to go 15 times 15 gives me 225. So I write that up here.
Yes.
So I have 225. So we know our answer. Then I'm going to take 13, and on our calculator here, I can go 13, and I'm going to use the little chevron key, which is going to raise it to a power, and I'm going to plug in 5, and I'm going to say enter, which gives me 371,291. So I have this now is 371,293. Okay?
Okay.
So we're going to multiply those together, right? So I'm going to go multiply answer by 225, and I should get 8 million, some huge number here. So I have this equals 8,354,092,5. Let me make this work.
8,359.
Nope, it's more than that. It's 83,540,925. That's a huge number. All right? But that's how we're going to do that. So now, all right, what do we have to do on the next one now?
We have to do 20 to the 18th power.
Well,
20 to the third power.
Well, I have 20 squared, which is 20 times 20, right?
Okay.
And then I'm going to multiply that by 18 times 18 times 18, all right?
Okay.
So I'm going to come over here, and I'm going to clear out our calculator here, and I'm going to go, okay, I'm going to put the first one in, 18 to the third power. Get an answer of 5,832, and I'm going to multiply that now by, I'm going to take that answer and I'm going to multiply by 20 squared, all right?
Okay.
And I've just, and I know 20 times 20 is going to give me 400, okay?
Okay.
So 400 times that 5,000 gives me 233.
I was going to multiply that.
Let me get rid of my little, all right? So I want to get to this last one because this last one's kind of tricky. So that gives us an answer of 2 million.
I think I remember that 10, anything times 10 to the negative 1 power is that same number, so it would be 10, right?
Well, 1 to the negative first power is going to give me a fraction. It's going to give me 1 over that number. So 1 to the negative 10th, and if we plug it in our calculator here, if I go 10 multiplied to the negative 1 power, I'm going to get 0.1. And that's what 1 divided by 10 actually gives me equals 0.1. All right, so any number to the negative 1 power is going to be that a fraction, 1 over that number, okay?
Okay.
So now we have 0.1 times 20 to the third power. All right, so let's come over and check on our calculator, all right? So let's do this again. We're going to go 10 to the negative 1 gives me 0.1, and now we're going to multiply that by 20 to the third power. Oops.
Okay.
Times 20 to, oh, I'm clearing it. Here we go. 20. There we go. So 8,000 times 0.1 gives me an 800. All right?
Okay.
So 20 to the third equals 8,000. And when I multiply that by 0.1, I'm moving my decimal place over 1, which gives me 800. All right? So we're going to box our answers here so that we know that this one goes with this. That one goes with here, and our huge number here goes with our first question there, all right? So those are some really good questions there, Aaron. I'm glad you called in. I'm glad we could get you.
I signed up for America's Got Talent, and maybe I can sing for you one time.
All right. Thanks, Aaron. Have a great night.
Newton's first law of motion states that an object at rest tends to stay at rest, and an object in motion tends to stay in motion with the same direction and speed unless interfered with.
Right, that was very interesting, and actually it leads into a lesson I've been working on with the kids with order of operations.
Sounds good.
All right, so we talked about order of operations. We did one problem last Tuesday, and I left it up here. And remember that there's a bunch of different ways out there. When I was in school, I learned PEMDAS, and then the Common Core changed it to either BEMDAS or GEMDAS. But remember, some of you out there have also learned other ways. As long as the multiply and divide are here, it doesn't matter which order. Like somebody actually said, hey, I learned it as BEDMAS. Well, that's fine. It's the exact same thing, okay? Because the multiply and divide are left to right anyway. So we did this first problem, and we got a 17. I took the exact same numbers as what was in that first problem, but I grouped them and I started to move them around to show you that numbers, when they're in order of operations, actually come up different. So first thing, BEMDAS, GEMDAS, PEMDAS, whatever, we have to do the parentheses. So we're gonna do the 2 + 5 first. So that gives us 7. And then we write the rest of the equation out. So 7 × 4 − 7 + 2. So now there's no exponents, so there's no e. Now we have multiply and divide. And remember, it's sort of like the hopscotch where you have to do left to right. So as I hit multiply or divide, I have to do those problems, reading left to right. So I read this problem, I got 7 × 4. That's gonna give me 28. And there's no division, so I'm done there. Now I'm gonna go and I'm gonna look and I'm like, oh, okay, just like in the hopscotch, addition and subtraction, left to right, as you read them. All right, so what we're gonna do is we're gonna do 28 − 7. So 28 − 7 = 21. Then the +2, and 21 + 2 = 23. So just by grouping two numbers together, my answer went from 17 to 23. So now if I sort of look at it down here and look at it a little different, I grouped it a little differently. Again, we gotta follow order of operations. Parentheses, brackets, whatever, first. So now we have 7 + 2, so that's a 9. We're gonna copy the rest. Now we have to do multiply, divide, like you're reading a sentence, left to right as you go along. So here, oh, no. Oh, but here's 5 × 4. That's 20. And then −9. And now we're at the add, subtract. So we have to do that left to right as well. So as we do it, so 2 + 20 = 22 −9. Get myself a little room here. 22 − 9 is same as 20 − 7, which is 13. So you can see just based on wherever the parentheses or the groupings are, I got 3 different answers. So please be very careful to follow order of operations in order to get your correct answers. Thank you.
Need help with your homework? Call Dial a Teacher for free at 1-888-986-2345. And don't forget, Dial a Teacher is open Monday through Thursday from 3:30 to 7 p.m.
A winner in tonight's creature teaser. I believe Maria's on
Maria,
the line.
Maria, yes.
Hi, Maria.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
How are you?
So what was this animal we were talking about?
And what are we talking about?
Oh, yes. We're still here.
What's your name?
Maria.
No, you phone.
Maria, can you talk to us on the phone, honey, and tell us what we were talking about?
Guanaco.
Guanaco, good.
Okay.
So what were the clues that we gave you that helped you determine this animal?
Because first I thought that you were going to say black skin, and then I thought it was white.
Ah.
Ah.
Cool.
And there's two difference because there's another one.
Oh, all right. I didn't know that.
I didn't know that either.
Cool.
Did you know that they used to be hunted for their fur, their wool?
Yes.
Yep, and they live in high mountain ranges, 13,000 feet. That's like almost close to 2 miles or so. Congratulations, Maria. Don't forget, every correct response goes into our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame. Earn enough points, and you, Maria, could win a tablet at the end of the season.
That's all the time we have for tonight. We're saying goodbye, but Dial-A-Teacher is available with free homework help on the phone until 7 tonight.
Tomorrow on Homework Hotline, we'll look at what is being done to recycle worn-out wind turbines. See you then. Good night.
Good night.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.